Amen. There you go. We've got it. Okay. Amen. So just to let you know that Pastor Jerry is not with us today because, you know, he is the presbyter of PAOC. And he was sent to help a church. It's a Korean-Chinese, it's a mixed pastors there, that he was there, like, you know, put the order. Like, he's there to really counsel the leaders and everything. So he's there with the camp at Peterborough something. And then, I don't know. And of course, the team of the Trinidad Mission is doing so well. And these young people, the next generation, are making an impact to the nations and really training the next generation in Trinidad to rise up and be the sons in the house. And of course, our heart breaks because the school, the lead school is done. Oh, yeah, it's so sad. It's been a month that we're together, like talking to them, pouring out our lives, knowing the principle of God, learning and studying and doing life together. And we are really a family, and we have so much faith in God, Pastor Jerry and I, that these are the seven people. Okay, seven of you, can you stand up? The seven mighty men and women of God that really choose to learn and study. And I believe in my heart that God will use them to change the culture and things in Scarborough. They had a dream, really, to do a great and lot. Just encourage them more, parents, because they're still young. They will still commit some errors. But you know what? Bring them and encourage them more to do greater things in the kingdom of God. Amen? Amen. So, you know, today is a very, you know, this message really speak in my heart, taught in my heart so well. And even I taught it in the lead school about understanding the cross. Amen. Of course, we need to understand, we typically view the cross and salvation as a golden ticket for our lives. The reality is that the cross has distinct purpose in God's redemption plan. It is not only to redeem us, but to redeem us from much larger purpose. Amen? I grew up in a faith of seeing the cross, this cross. I borrowed this one. Let me show it to you. It's still there. Okay. So I grew up in a faith just seeing this cross all the time. Even in our door, every room, my mom hung it. Because she believed so much that there is a power in this cross. So everywhere I turn around, because our family are very religious, we grew up really praying and understanding who's God in our life, but not in a deeper sense. There's something that, you know, even though it's hung, I grew up in a nun school, study and pass theology, and not really truly understand. And I check again. I grew up in this in the Philippines, the College of the Holy Spirit. Our uniform are all white because we are the Holy Spirit, all white. No boys allowed. Amen. But we see on the other side the boys. Amen. Every Easter we have this tradition to watch the Passion play. We need to be holy and not eat meat. My mom said, you cannot eat meat because it's a holy week. We try to be holy and not to do anything, especially after three, because we already know that Jesus is already dead. And every year I know, what I know is every year Jesus is dying, every 3 o'clock. Yeah. I grew up understanding Jesus needs to die every Holy Week. That's why my mom said, after three, you cannot even take a bath. You cannot do anything. You cannot say anything. Of course, you know, we're holy. When I got born again, one step forward, I know that and understand Jesus died. I understand the cross, that Jesus died for my sin now and have eternal life. Amen? That's cool to understand. You know, I just want to share to you one life group. We call it Bible study. This leader is so frustrated of trying to encourage the people to really change their life. And week after week, they're meeting. And then one day, one meeting, one Friday, she said, "There's no Bible study today. I will not talk. And I just want you to kneel down and talk to the cross." You know, of course, in obedience, all of them kneeled down because she was frustrated that they're not changing their life. Whenever they call them, they're not available. But you know what? They see them in parties. Right? See, when you call for cell group, they always say they have a lot of reason, and then they're not changing. So she was so frustrated. So one day she said, "No more teaching. Here's the cross. All of you talk to the cross." And of course, you know, they're so obedient because, you know, they want to change too. The heart of these people wants changes too. They want things to happen in their lives. And of course, I asked her after several weeks, I asked her, "Did they change after talking to the cross?" And he said, "Oh, Pastor Elby, I give up. They're not changing at all." So, you know what? They're not changing because of they don't want to change. Because people perish because of lack of knowledge. Amen? They perish. They don't know. I know that that cross been hanging there for how many years in my life that I don't know what the cross does in my life. People perish because of lack of knowledge. And today, for us not to perish, I want to share to you the understanding of the cross. The will, the works, and the way of the cross. Let us pray. Father, I just want to thank you for appointing me today, oh God, for us all to understand, oh God, the will, the works, oh God, and the way of the cross. Lord, I pray for the power of the Holy Spirit to be upon each one of us. That truly every word is not me, O God, but it's your word, O God, that's coming out of my mouth, that it will bring change and transformation, that we will value, O God, the cross, O God. Father, we just want to thank you and give praise to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, the will of the cross. Many people think that God's only purpose for us is to be saved. Amen? Salvation is very important. However, it is vital to understand that Jesus' death on the cross, it means to an end. It is not the end itself. Do you agree? It is meant to end, but it is not the end itself. In John 10:9, "I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved." Amen. Jesus compared himself as the gate or the door, illustrating to us that salvation is not the end, but something we are meant to walk through and work it out in our lives. Okay? Salvation is the beginning. It's just the beginning. When we accepted the Lord as our Lord, our Savior, it is just the beginning. And there's a lot of things that needs to work in our lives. That's why salvation, of course, so many churches preach focus only on the gospel of salvation. Well, you need to be saved. You need to be born again. Because, you know, it's a golden ticket to heaven. Yes, it is true, but not true. Amen. It's not a golden ticket because you know what? When we are saved, we need to understand the other gospel, the kingdom of God gospel. Amen. Because the kingdom of the gospel, it talks about the order and the rule of God. Because you know what? We are saved, but many things in our life are still out of order. Do you agree? Our tongue is not ruled yet. Our mind is not ruled according to the principle of God. Amen? When sin entered in, it caused damage and disorder into the lives of people. That's why we are all out of order. That's why, you know what? Because of the great love of the Father, He sent Jesus to us. And Jesus came and brought the government on His shoulder. He carried the rule and the order of God in His shoulder. And that is the kingdom of God. And we know in the gospel, Jesus preached, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. You know what he's saying? Repent. Because the kingdom, the rule and order of God is here. Repent. Fix your life in order of God. Amen? It's not repent, the Lord is coming, because until now, the Lord is not here yet. But since then, when he came, he said, repent. The kingdom of God is at hand. It means repent. Here's the truth. You're out of order. Repent. Fix your life. Put your life in order according and aligned to the will and the purpose of God in your life. That is the kingdom order. Fix your life. Amen. The kingdom of gospel is about the rule and order. And that's very hard. It means we need to deal many things in our heart. It means we need to deal in our heart. It means it needs to align our attitude in the ways of God. Our attitude, our hearts, we need to put it in order. Kingdom order is to deal with our hearts and our being. Are we really representing and reflecting God in our life? When we talk, are they seeing God? Is our tongue seasoned well? And that's why he said, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent, I'm bringing the rule and order of God. Align yourself and fix yourself. That is the kingdom gospel. God predestined us according to the purpose of his will. It is more than just receiving salvation, my friends. In Ephesians 1:5, he predestined us for the adoption of sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will. Predestined means ordained beforehand, purpose that is so fixed. It means God's will is concerned that what he wants us to do, his desire, his purpose, and his plan. You know, we know and quote all the time, Jeremiah 29:11, for his plan for me is to prosper and not to harm me and give me hope and future. But you know what? The moment you get out of the plan, you will get harm. That's what the Lord is saying to us. The moment you get that. Because you know what? Predestined. He fixed it already. He fixed already our destiny. His plan. His purpose. It's all fixed. But you know what? It's our choice to choose it. He fixed it. He fixed it already. That's why, you know what? One thing that God will not violate is our will. If you don't like him, cool. He will not touch you. Right? Cool. No, but he's just waiting for you. Waiting and waiting. The moment you call me, Jesus, his hand is extended immediately to you. You know, predestined plan is the moment. That's why, you know, the grace of God is so long. Because, you know, he planned it already so well. That's why when you have the Lord and suddenly you backslide. Suddenly you struggle, you fall, and you know what? The moment said, Jesus, he pick you up immediately and puts you into your destiny. He always pick you up. He always there because his desire and plan is there. But you know what? That is the grace. That's why this grace is so long. Because you know what? He doesn't want you to perish. He wants you to have an abundant life that is so good. He wants success for you. He wants to process you. But it should be in his plan, not your plan. Amen. It should be in his kingdom order, not your order. You have to align with him. Because when you align with him, you have all the authority and power. Because he has given you the keys to the kingdom to unlock everything. Wow. My God. Have these keys. Well, you know what? Have the keys that God have given us. It's unlocking everything. You want to unlock prosperity. You want to unlock goodness in your life. He has given you the kingdom. Keys. The moment you unlock, because you know what? He has given it to you. But it should be aligned to the purpose and the will of God in your life. That's why the cross is the will of God in your life. Amen. 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 But you seek me and find me with all your heart. You know what? Seek me, find me. God is not hiding His will to you. Never. You know, the moment say, I want God, all your will and purpose in my, every plan will be revealed upon you. You will walk in your full destiny as you walk and align yourself. You know, mystery will be unfold to you. Things will come to you. Knowledge will come to you and say, wow, it's so good. Because He predestined everything to you. It's only up to you to access and walk in it. Amen? Glory to God. It means it takes your decision to choose His will, plan, and purpose. Not only choose the words, and not only choose, but you need to intentionally walk on it. We can know and we have a knowledge, but walking is another step because walking is very hard. We can have all this knowledge here. Woo! That's why we pop up. Because that knowledge should go here. That's why demonstration, revelation. Amen. When God have given us the word, these are all information until it gets into our heart, until it's illumined by the Holy Spirit. It means illumined. It will come to your heart. And you know, this is a delicate one. This is the one pumping all the vessels in our, all the vessels, right? It's connected. The moment we are dead, boom, that's it. That's why spiritually, sometimes we are dead because there is no transformation in the heart. But you know, when that word that you receive will come into your head, illumined by the Holy Spirit, you know what? It goes to your heart and bring transformation. When you are transformed, you can hold it, but demonstrate. Demonstrate forgiveness. Demonstrate holiness. Demonstrate compassion and commitment. That's why there's no demonstration. In the house of God, in every unit, there's no demonstration. Because you know what? There's no transformation. We really don't know the will of the cross. We are saved. But that's not the ticket to heaven. Amen? You know what? In our house, in CLC, we are strong in discipleship. We are strong in mentoring. We want that. We want that. We want fathering for each one of you. We try to position and make you understand because, you know, it's needed. It's needed. You know, these care group leaders, coaches, pastors that's walking alongside with you is not only to encourage you, to love and support you. They are there always to say, come on, let's go. Cheer you up. Let's go. Let's do this. But you know what? They are there too. That God placed over you that these people will pinpoint the out of order in your life. Amen. And that's not easy. These are the people who will speak to you with wisdom and say, I think you're out of order and you're not aligned. But you know, most of us doesn't like it. Right? We want only salvation. We only, let's have love. when people are committing errors already and say, the grace of God is there. You know the binary truth? The lion and the lamb? Jesus is a lion and a lamb. He's a lamb that full of love nurture you. But He is also a lion, a government, the rule that will align everything in your life. Sometimes your leader is a lion, a lamb. Sometimes they are a lion. Both of them, they need to function. Because you know what? Two truths together will produce power. It cannot only be half. It cannot only one side. Because there's no two truths together that produce the power. You can only have the result when you combine the truth. That's why we are raising our children, we need to be lion and the lamb to them. We need to be loving and caring and support. Wow, so good. But if they are out of order, we need to be a lion to them. Come on, let's align this now. Let's fix it. You're out of order. Come on, let's fix it. I still love you, but we need to fix it. Same thing in the house of God. Why not in the house of God? Why not? You know what? As a family, we can be a lion and a lamb to you. Because now, you know, when we put that together, it will bring result to you. You will be somebody in the kingdom. You will be the son in the house. You will be the one who will raise the standard of the kingdom. You are the one who will reflect, represent Christ. Amen. 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 It's not about our own desire. The cross is not about our own desire, but the plan and purpose of what He wants for our life, but the will of God in our life. How do we find the will of God? In Matthew 7, how come it's so important to know to walk in God's will? Why? In Matthew 7:21-22, not everyone who say to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name drive out demons in Jesus' name? And in your name perform many miracles? You know what? The cross should remind us that every day we need to choose the will of God to rule and reign in our lives. Amen. What are the things that we need to put in order in our lives? I just want you to think, you know, I just want you to just, you know, like while I'm saying, just think about it. What are the things that needs to put in order in my, how about the secret sin? How about the secret sin you've been carrying and hiding for a long time that nobody knows? How about this secret sin that it's been there sitting for you, and yet when you come here, you look like so holy, and yet you have this secret sin. It's secret. But God knows. That's why you have the guilt in your heart. How about our bad temper? Like your fuse is so little. One more, boom, all the pots and pan are flying already. How about this bad temper? How about the bitterness? The bitterness we've been carrying in our hearts. This bitterness is, it's there, that it's like a toxic, an acid that's destroying us. How about uncontrolled anger? How about hidden envy and jealousy? That you cannot say you're envy, you're jealous. That you will just try to do something to this person because it's your envy and you're jealous. You know, it's hard to say I'm envy, I'm jealous, because you know, but you will just make episode. You will create things that you know that will destroy this person because you're envy, you're jealous. Amen. How about the uncontrolled tongue? You're so good of speaking other faults and judging other person. How about this? Whenever you look at them, you quickly judge. When you look at them, you judge already. And you don't know yet the person. You're so quick. You're so quick to judge the person, and yet you don't know that this is the best person. That you don't know they have a pure heart. And many times they don't like me in the church because the way I look, because I always look excited, you know, because I look like that. Whenever I'm so interested with someone, I look like that. And they thought I'm really bad, like I'm angry. No, it's just my mom brought me into this world. I wish I can go and fix it, you know. But you know what? I love all of you. Amen. So we judge easily, and that is out of order. That's out of order. Amen. Not only the cross remind us to put our lives in order, also the cross, the will of the cross remind us to reconcile us to the Father. Ministry of reconciliation. He died at the cross for us to reconcile. You know what's that? Relationship. That is tremendous relationship. Relationship is everything. Amen? So, you know, in the two commandments in Matthew, it's summarized, love your God with all your heart, mind, and soul. How do you love your God? How do you love Him? Do you have time to talk to Him? Or you're so busy and so tired because you work so late and you don't have time? You know, if He's really your Father and your Daddy, you will just say, Daddy, Daddy, I'm hurting, you know. Daddy, I don't know what to do, you know. Because you have a relationship, you just keep talking to Him and said, okay, Daddy, I'm going to cross, you know, I'm going to drive in this, please the lane, you know. Daddy, you protect me. That is a relationship. And the Father is longing for that. You know how lonely He is if you're not talking? Us as a parents, if our family, if our children are not talking to us, there's something wrong. We're longing for it. We want our children to come with us and tell stories to us, not to text us or email us. You know the communication right now? How are you? You know, I'm here, I'm home. They just text you. They just email to you. And most of the time, okay, it's Daddy's birthday. We will have a get together. Oh, I'm so busy. I cannot make it. Wow. Is that relationship? No. It's out of order. Because you know what? In email, text, there's no emotion. Right? There's no emotion. And I want a relationship. Even in my children, I said, hey, can you just talk to me just for a minute? Just down. Just sit down, Michelle. I know you're busy. But can we just tell story? And family, tell stories. We want to eat together and tell stories. And how's your day? But you know what? Because of the busyness, how the devil tried to destroy relationship because of the busyness. Parents, no, I need to earn money so I can provide for my children. So you know, the children lock up themselves at the room and they don't understand. They're so lonely. You know, when they are locked up in the room, it's dangerous what they're doing there. Right? It's dangerous. So we need to give time to them. We need to build relationship. We need to be there with them. That's why Pastor Jerry is saying we need to balance our life. When you're home, you're home. Yes. You need to drop everything and pay attention to them and say, okay, what's going on to you? Same thing with our Heavenly Father. Do we have a prayer time that we will communicate to them? To Him everything, and yet He is the Father who's longing for us, who's desiring that we will tell story to Him. He's the Father who's waiting. Yes, you know, if you ask me, then I will bless you. If you do this, my help is there. My hand is extended to you. Everything that you move, I'm there for you. He's just waiting for us. Do we have an intimate relationship with our Heavenly Father? And what is the second command of relationship? Love your neighbor. Check your relationship. I mean, your neighbor is the people around you. Your spouse, your children, your parents, your leaders, your office mate. All these things are your neighbor. What is your relationship with them? If you are in your workplace, are you reflecting Christ? Do you have a good relationship? If you're home, do you have a good relationship with your parents, children? Parents, do you have a good relationship with your children? You know, I've been counseling a lot of children and it's break my heart because many of them say, you know, I cannot express I love my dad. I can't. I said, why? There's no relationship. And yet, the will of the cross is about relationship. You know what? If we don't have a real deep relationship with our Heavenly Father, we cannot give a true relationship to our family. It's just fake. Amen? So, you cannot give what you don't have. You can only give what you have. You can impart what you have. Amen? So I want you, you know, how's your relationship with your leaders in the house of God? Then it's time to fix. It's time. Do we have a relationship with our parents? Do we have really time, a relationship with our children? And if it's not, if it's out of order, this is the time to fix it. Because sometimes it's too late. Sometimes it's too late. It's been damaged already. Amen? In Matthew 12:50, "For whoever does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and my mother." Family carries out the will of the Father. Amen? It's so nice to understand this. What makes and binds us together is when we are obeying the will of God in our lives. The connection and the link to us is we are obeying His will. We are not an association or a club. You know, that's why we're saying we are a family of God. We choose to be here, each one of us, and saved by God. We choose to be here as a family of God because our purpose and our desire is to abide to the will of God. Amen? Amen? So, let me ask you, okay, you know, because you know I'm here, Mama is here. How about our relationship in the family of God? You know what? We are a family as a mom in the house. Can I just share my heart to each one of you? So there will be an order in the house of God. Because you know what? I always say that, you know, in your own house, you will not allow and you will get angry if some of your kids will just go and not tell you where they are. Amen? You're going to freak out and say, "Ha! Why are you doing? This is totally disrespect and dishonoring." How about in the family of God? You know what? Jesus compared a family, you know, the pattern and order is compared to a family. Amen. The submission and order. How about in the family of God? You know what? If you will go somewhere, please let us know. Let's just put an order in the house. Because I know you are so matured. You know the Lord. Don't just go without telling your parents. Who is your parent? Your life group leaders. Your coaches, your pastor. You can just say, "I'm sorry, I'm not." You know, we don't want to control your life that you want to go there. No, that's not our intention. But we just need to put everything in order. Can you please tell us, you know, "I'm not coming"? Because if you consider this as your home and your house, then let's work it out right before the Lord. Because you will not do that in your own home, and yet you're doing it in the house of God. Can I hear amen? Amen. I love you, Mama E. Can we do that? Let's put it in order because we want to mature. We want to be accountable. We want honor, respect, right? It's just I feel this disrespected. You know when we call you, "Oh, why are you calling?" "Why are you calling?" And if you don't call, it's already 3 weeks they're not calling me. We don't know where to put ourselves. But you know what? If there's an order, if the rule and God is governed inside of us, you don't need rules, right? Rules is only for people who is not governed inside. But if you are ruled internally, you know what? You don't need to tell me, "Mama E, I'm not going there this Sunday." You will not see me. That's good. What's wrong with that? Amen? Put everything in order. Our relationship, we want our relationship to be a family. We want our relationship to be matured. We want, because Jesus died at the cross for relationship, we want that relationship to nourish and flourish. We want really parent. We want to parent you and raise you to be mature. We want you to see success in your destiny. That's all we want. Yes, When you're not, you know, when you're struggling, when you're sick, we want there to pray for you. We want to encourage you and support you. That's all our heart in the family. What a good family. Amen. What a good family. Don't you like that? I love it. Amen. Disconnect and disalignment happen when we are not walking together in the will of God. Of course, disconnect and disalignment. Of course, if you have your own thing and you are not, then we will disconnect. Period. We will not. But as the word of God, as we walk together in the will of God, you are my brother and my sister. Amen. Amen. Okay, we have responsibility to carry and model the will, the rule of God, especially to our next generation. We need to model it. We need to model it to them. These people are you know, looking up to us. If we don't see that there is honoring in this house, guess what? They will do the same thing. Amen? Amen. And we don't want that anymore. Amen? Knowing God's will, of course. How do we know God's will? Psalm 119, 1 to 6. Blessed are those whose ways are blameless, who walk according to the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep His statutes and seek Him with all their hearts. They do not wrong, but follow His way. You have laid precepts that are to be fully obeyed. Oh, that may were steadfast in obeying your decree, then I would not be put to shame when I consider all your commands. Amen. That's how. You know, precept is every word of God is a decree and law of God to bring order in our life. We mean really that the word of God, meditate the word of God day and night, day and night. We need to really every precept. We need to understand because that's all the will and the will of God in our life, that we will never make a mistake. Amen. The fault and the error is if we are not fully seeking the Lord. We are selective many times, oh, even in the preaching, oh, that's not good, you know, that's not mine, you know, I'm okay already. But we are selective and many times we manipulate and turn around the law of God in our convenience and comfort. We many times that we say that, oh, the Lord understand anyway. Yeah. He's a good God. He understand that I cannot come on Sunday. He understand all these things that I will not. No. God is saying, no, you don't understand. And the Lord, and you keep saying, you understand. And the Lord says, no, my child, you don't understand. If you will just obey me, I will open the doors of opportunity to you. And you say, no, because this is my way. And God, no, that is not the way. You don't understand, my child. No, you understand, Lord. And you keep it back and forth because you become selective. You try to maneuver and manipulate the law of God. I counsel teenage pregnancy. These things happen because there is a great consequence. Because I told her, you are suffering so much. Not only you, but your entire family. Why? Because you violated the law of God. You need to understand the consequence when we violate the law of God. Same thing all the time. I always say, you know why? Why you do that? You say, one night affair. Something happened. It's disgrace, dishonor in the whole family because one thing, you violated the law of God. If you have the fear of God, you will not do that. But God is forgiving and loving. The only thing, there is a souvenir now. There is this child that reminds you all the time what happened. Right? It's like a prisoner. You know, even you ask forgiveness because you violated the law of the land, you should still go to the prison for 20 years. Amen? So that's how important that we need to understand that the law, the will of God is all written in the Word of God, precept by precept, that Word of God should align and put order in our lives. All the purpose, the plans are there. It's only up to us, and it's our decision to choose and walk on it. Amen. The next thing of the cross is the work of the cross. Amen. Knowing and understanding the will of the Father causes us to work and give our lives to fulfilling His will. There is work to be done in His will. So for us to mature. Amen. So we cannot just idle. In Philippians 2, 12, 13, therefore, my dear friend, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you to will and to act according to His good purpose. What Paul is saying to the Philippians is say, you need to works. You need to works your salvation with fear and trembling. It means that, you know, you need to get away from your evil companions. Don't participate in lies. Don't go to these people who always complain. Don't be part of that. You know, when people are so miserable and you know, saying many things, I just close my ears because I don't want to be part of it. I just don't want to. I choose not to be part. I choose to be aligned in God's will. That I will have life because I want a joyful life in my life. I'm getting old and I want a good life. Amen? Because you know what? There's always consequence. You might be saved from many dangers if you get out of it. Amen? One bad choice, bad decision can cause damage in your life because there is really a consequence. One night affair damages you and your whole family. It affects one drugs will you will be addicted. One just tried drugs and it will come to you. One only thing. You know how the devil is so good to use media all the time. In 5 seconds when you watch it, it will capture you. That's why parents, we need to screen everything because it will capture them and you just don't know they are already addicted to it. It's just the media is so bad. That's why we need to have a wisdom of God. We need to understand. You know, we need to protect us from all these things. That's why we need to work with fear and trembling. Amen? What are the things that we need to work out? What are the things? We need to work out our bad attitude. The anger. The arrogance. That we are so arrogant. We want always your way. How about we need to work out our submission to authority? We need to work out that we will honor and respect them. What is the thing that we need to work out? The rebellion spirit that we need to knock it out. Not on you, always on your way, you know? You need to work very hard to die in your flesh. You know what is what? It reminds us to work this one. It reminds us all the time to see the passion play that is dying. You crucify me, Lord. Crucify this flesh. I need to die from this flesh. Crucify it. Kill it, Lord. That every day we need to die from our flesh so the will of God will reign in our hearts. A lot of works. It's not easy to kill all these things. It's not easy to control your temper. It's not, but we need to be intentional to daily die. To daily crucify this flesh so the Spirit of God will rise in us. That's why it takes a lot of working. Amen? Submission is very hard. Especially when you see imperfect parents, you're going to submit. But what the Lord, our greatest model, is Jesus. He submitted to the imperfect parents even though He's God. That's why the Heavenly Father is so well pleased to Him and say, this is my beloved Son, His beloved Son, because you know, it's His submission. The Father is so pleased. And how we can please the Lord? How we can please God? Submit to His will. Submit to your parents. Submit yourself. And you know what? Don't worry about anything. All of us are accountable to God. If they are in error, they will face it to God. But your thing is just you need to submit to the authority that God has placed over you. Amen? We need to work it out. What are the things that we need to work it out? Let's work out to be generous of expressing our love. Let's work out of generous of appreciating people. Let's work out to be generous to thank people. You know what? That's the one that we are not generous. And some people cannot express love. Some people cannot say thank you. Some people cannot. There's so, ano yung matipid? Huh? Stingy. They don't want to express. They don't want to express. They don't want to do that. It's like a match of feeling, especially for the spouse, for the husband. It's not cool for them to say, I love you, no, honey. Because they're macho. They have full of pride. But you know what? A matured son and daughter of the Lord, they are very expressive. Let's work it out. Some of the people that I'm counseling, I said, let's express love. Just say hi to your dad. Say to your dad and mom, how are you? I think you're working so hard. You know, kids, if we say that to our parents, you know, we will be blessed more. You know, they need, because they work so hard. They give the best to you. And all you can I give you some coffee? How are you, Dad? You look so tired. You know, one word will bless their heart. And you know what? One appreciation, we can run the race more. One thank you, we can do greater things in the kingdom. One encouragement, we can pursue greater things. But we want that. We want that to be, we need to express it. Let's be generous. Let's work it out to be generous of expressing the good thing. Amen? Let's do this as a family of God. Amen? Can we do that? Yeah. That's why you've heard Pastor Bisnu, and he's saying God's workshop. We need to go through the process of refining, process of remolding, and the process of reshaping. Work it out. Work it out. Let's work it out. All the things that is not in order of God, let's work it out. The relationship that is not in order, fix it. Our attitude, our temper, our arrogance, our submission, let's work it out. Amen? Amen. In James 1:22, do not merely listen to the word. And so deceive yourself. Do what it says. Did you hear me? James is telling, do what it say. Do what it say. Do it. You know, life of obedience that Pastor Jerry have taught you last week. Just do it. Walk the talk. Model it. Reflect that you are the true sons in the house. Reflect, demonstrate humility. Demonstrate passion. Demonstrate commitment. Demonstrate faithfulness. Demonstrate submission in the house of God. Demonstrate joy and peace and forgiveness. And the greatness is reflect the love of God. You know, love, love, love. Love, love, love. You know, love conquers everything. Love conquers the multitude of sin. You know, the power of love. Because you know, one thing that the devil doesn't have is love. He can duplicate everything but not love, because he doesn't have love. But you know, when a person is so angry to you and doesn't like you, just love them. Hug them. Because love conquers everything. Amen? Let's reflect it. Let's just do it. Don't do many things anymore. And you know, many times you say, okay, you need to forgive this person. Give me space. I'm not ready yet. I said that before. That's why I know. Give me space. Give me time. But you know what? You are the one who is captured and not free. If you don't want to release the forgiveness, you're the one in captives. But you know what? With the Lord, the moment you say, Lord, forgive me, boom, his hand is extended to you. Come on, child, let's go. You're forgiven. Wow. You're forgiven. There's no, give me space. Because always, always mock the Lord in many ways in our lives. But the moment we say, forgive me, Lord, his hand is extended to you. His grace is there for you. His love is there for you. Unconditional. I love you. I love you. I love you. That is the cross. You know what? It cost Jesus, the true Son, to give his life in obedience. He is our greatest example. He is our greatest. His life, to be in obedience to the will of the Father, to do his work willfully. He submit himself to the vision of the Father. He was back, crucified, but never reviled back until to the end, until he said, "Father, it is finished." He gave his life to the glory and give glory to the Father. When we do the works of the cross in accordance to his will, our works become less about us. And what we get is the more about God and what we can offer him. Compared to Jesus, the sacrifice on the cross, no sacrifice can be too big of what he has done. Our mindset should be consistently, I do not want an easy life, but I want a fulfilled life. One filled with the vision of God to do his will and willingness to give our lives for his works. You know what? When the Lord have called me to do these things, my father was so disappointed and said, "What are you doing? You finish your career. What are you doing? You're going to the remote. You will be killed there." You know, I said to my father, "You know what? Thanks for everything, but I'm more fulfilled right now. Because you know what? I'm part of what God is doing. It made me fulfilled when broken homes are being restored and I'm part of it. When marriage are falling apart and I'm there and I'm a witness, I'm so fulfilled because I'm part of it. When one person is drug addicted, then counsel and give life, I'm part of it. I'm more fulfilled. It's not an easy job because you have to do a lot of things. You have to do a lot of work, a lot of counseling, a lot of prayer, but it makes me fulfilled because I know my desire is for the vision of the house of the Father. You know, I told one day, that's God, this life is nothing at all unless you use me to the max. I want to be used for your glory, and I'm praying and kneeling down to the Lord that this is nothing. And one day I was so sick and I said, "Lord, heal this body because this body, I want to serve this body is for your service. I want my mind to be full so when I counsel, I want my body to be strong so I can work with my husband day and night to do the works of the Lord. Heal me, Lord," and boom. God give me strength after strength. Realign my thoughts. Align my hormones. Yes. Align everything. Because the purpose of this body is to serve. It's not an easy life. It is a fulfilled life in the glory of the Lord. Amen. Well, the last one is the way of the cross. We have finished the will of the cross, and then the works of the cross. Now it's the way of the cross. There are many Christians who understand God's purpose for them and desire to serve him wholeheartedly, but struggle without knowing how to. God is the king of his kingdom, and as heirs of the kingdom, it is essential that not only do we know and love God, we also need to do things in his ways. Amen. It is essential that we hear from God for each season and situation of our life. You know how we have many seasons in our life and it never stops. Once it's finished, there's another season. I said, "When is that gonna end?" And the Lord said, "Until you see me, that's the ending of your season." Every season, every situation, we need to do the way of the Lord. It is not just enough to know what's God's will, yes, and how to do the works, but we need to also know how to do his way and to walk it out. Amen. John 14:6, Jesus answered, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." If he is the only way to the Father, it is imperative we do not try any other paths. Amen. Matthew 7:13-14. Enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the road to leads to destruction, and many enters through it. But small is the gate and narrow the road that leads to life, and only few find it. Any alternative way of doing things will result in walking in error and cause you to be out of God's covering and blessing and provision. Amen. So we need to learn to do things God's way and not just our ways. And many times you thought, you know, it seems right, but it leads to destruction and death. You know how we know it's confirmed? And many times that's why we have a parents that's walking with you. We have a cell group that's walking with you, along with you. Because God will use these people with you and confirm the way. And many times we strongly, you know, believe in mentoring, discipleship, because that is a safety for you. That you have a parent in the house. That you have someone that's fathering with you and walking with you strongly. They are the people that God placed over you to speak life into you and to give guidance and direction in your life. In Proverbs 11:14, where there is no counsel, the people fall. But in the multitude of counselor, there is safety. In New King James Version, NIV, for lack of guidance, a nation falls, but many advisor makes a victory sure. Godly counsel prevents you from making mistakes. Amen. You know, sometimes, you know, what's an error? We don't have anyone. We will just do things in your business, in your future, in your marriage, in your finances, in the direction of your ministry. There is someone that God has placed to you to counsel you, to give you. And usually that is your parents, spiritual parents in the Lord. Because they are there to give you counsel and affirm to you, this is the way. I'll be there and work with you. Amen? Because Isaiah 55:8, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways are my ways. Amen? Because we don't know. It's not the ways. We don't understand that sometimes we do our ways and then we miss it. If only we follow, because sometimes it's not on our understanding. It's beyond, it's many unknown when we try to follow God. But you know when God is prompting to you, and usually the people that's walking with you will affirm it and say, go ahead, go, do it. And you will see, you will enter into the gate of promises and future in the Lord. Amen? God's doing God's will, His work and His way requires humility and servant heart. That's why you need to be broken before the Lord. There's no arrogance. Oh, this is the way, Lord. Oh, I heard from God. Do you really heard from the Lord? You know, let's be careful of what we are doing, because you know what? It seems right, but it leads to death and destruction. You thought it's right, and the devil will give you affirmation. Oh, it's right, but it leads to death. And when your parent is saying to you, not that, telling to you already, but you still insist because you have your own way. Okay, go ahead. But later on, if it's a mistake, I'll just pray for you. All the time they said, oh, Mama E, I think I heard from her. Okay, go ahead. But later on, when things happen that is not right, I'll be there for you, but I'll just pray for you for your mistakes. Amen. So there's great example in the Bible, like in 2 Samuel 6. This is the story. David believed that the will of God was to get the ark back in order for his presence to be amongst the people again. David defeated the Philistine and exhausted all his resources to bring the ark back, because they thought that's the way of the Lord, back and not God's way. He deployed 30,000 men, including musicians, and played instrument to march back, and even commissioned a brand new cart for the occasion of the victory, because who will make the mistakes? It's the ark of the covenant. Is that the way of God? The long story short, on the way back, because it's not the way of God, the ark tipped over because one of the oxen carrying the cart stumbled. And is it Uzzah? One of David's well-meaning men tried to stop it in order to protect the ark. But what happened? Uzzah resulted to die. And Uzzah being distracted today to death, because that is not the way of God. the order of God is not to touch. But because they have their own way, David, but David recognized, wow, I disobey God. This is not the way of the Lord. David's disobedience and the people, they didn't respect that. But David eventually realizes to be disobedient and returned to the instruction given by God to Moses. The ark was returned correctly and there was freedom and rejoicing. David repented and say, God, I will not ever do my way that I want to be. That's very dangerous. There are always consequences when we are in disobedient with God. Again, the greatest example is Jesus at the cross. Jesus, the true Son, choose God's will over his own and carry out God's plan, the Father's way. That's why in Luke 22:42, Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done. He willingly and obediently went to die on the cross and choose to submit his way to the Father. Jesus also demonstrated his obedience to God, God's way. And when he did not subject himself to bringing his rule and reign throughout violence. You know what? Why Jesus would say, I'm going to die. I will be crucified. But you know what? He didn't argue with his Father. He didn't even say, no, I will not. But he know already that he will face tremendous suffering, persecution. But you know what, Father? It is not my will, but your will be done. And when he obeyed, what happened? He brought redemption to the whole world. That's why we are free, because of what Jesus have done at the cross. It saved all of us. If he didn't obey, we are still in sin. Amen? We are not reconciled, but because of his obedience, it impacts until now the whole world. Yeah, in closing, we need to follow Jesus, the true Son. The cross is a larger purpose. It is not only for the sake of salvation. God has a will for our lives, and the best way to know it is spend time in his word. When we know God's will, it should cause us to work no matter what the cost. It will cost us. However, we need to make sure we do things God's way and submit to him. God's voice has to be the loudest. You know what? When you are broken, when you are humbled, this flesh are crucified. You know what? The spirit and the voice of God is the loudest that we can hear him, so we can do the will. That's why we do prayer and fasting. We need to fast, to die this flesh, so we can hear the direction of God. Whenever we do something in the ministry, both of us, me and Pastor Jerry, because we are so strong, we want to die in our flesh so we can hear the direction of God. We need to kill this flesh so the Spirit of God will rise, so we can hear the voice of God. Because we don't want, it's so dangerous to do our will. The ministry is so huge already that when we fall, we're gonna fall so strongly. So we are so careful that the cross is there all the time in front of us, that we need to be broken all the time and subject ourselves. What's your will, God? Lead us, oh God. Lead us that we can handle these people. The works is very large, Lord. But not our will, but your will be done, God. When we understand the fullness and the meaning of the cross, the will of the cross, the works of the cross, and the way of the cross. Today we have the opportunity to surrender our lives and acknowledge before God, yes, Lord, there's so many things out of order in my life. But I want to come before you, be broken. Timely, it is communion. Can I call the worship team? Before we take this communion,